pride is the devil. Think it got a hold on me. Pride is the devil. And left so many R.I.P. Pride is the devil. Think it got a hold on me. Pride is the devil. Paranoid, I put you over everything to fill the void. That when you're gone, will I have anything or will I be destroyed? Yeah.
Is that awkward? We struggle with patience. We struggle with waiting. Interestingly enough, there's a calculated risk in waiting for the first minute to say anything in a sermon, because statistics show that we lose interest within like the first minute and we decide whether whatever's going to be said is worth listening to or not. And so we decide if we're going to pay attention for the remainder of the 30 minutes or less based on the first minute. So calculated risk. Is it worth listening to? Silence. Is it awkward? Is it a space we always need to fill? Do we need to say hi? Do we need to giggle? Do we need to check our phone? Do we need to fill that space immediately? Statistically, absolutely. You're bored, you're anxious, you're nervous. You walk up to a space in 9-10, you don't know anybody. What do? You do this. Or you put music in. Like we need it, not like we need, it's a feeling, but it overwhelms us that we need to fill that space. And waiting is a massively uncomfortable thing for all of us. We're all there. That was awkward. For me. And I knew I was going to do it. And I was like, I don't know how this is going to come over. The other day, man, I was like moments away from victory. I was playing this game with Carissa, and it's like a game where you have to wait your turn and they take their turn and then you take your turn. And it's a series of moves that you make over this long course. And I'm like moments away. But I have to wait until Carissa takes her turn to then play my card, to achieve this task, to conquer this hero, to win the game. I lost. Because, not only because, but I was so impatient that I looked at my deck. Which is a no-no. That's called cheating. But I was so, and Chris's mom was sitting with Callie, and she's like, Scott, what did you just do? I looked at my deck. I'm sorry. I don't know what to do anymore. Are you laughing at me, Callie? So I was so impatient. The game we play is called Villainous. Anybody ever played that game? It's like a Disney game. It's like you have your own boards and you have your task, and your goal as this villain is to like achieve your victory. So I was playing as Syndrome. Anybody know who Syndrome is? Yeah. My goal was to send my droid out and defeat all the heroes and like be the best. That was my goal. And I was like moments away, but I needed this one card. And I had this fat stack of deck like that I started with, and the card that I needed was all at the bottom. I didn't know that. But I had been discarding to get to the bottom. And I was like, does this card even exist? So I looked, and that's cheating because I was so impatient. The whole point of the game is to play it. But I was impatient that I cheated because I felt uncomfortable with the waiting. And this is one small thing that is a series of things in my life that I choose to be impatient about. And without question, you are like me in the fact that we struggle to wait. And so we've been in this series called Disinformation, where we've been looking at deceptive ideas that play into disordered desires. And the disordered desire that I have, that you have, that we have is, man, we hate to be waiting people. We need instant gratification. I didn't want to say we hate to wait because it rhymed, and I was like, that's cheesy. But we hate to wait. You can write that down. Put that on your Twitter feed. But we're an instant gratification culture. Like, specifically in America, like, we have things at our fingertips all the time. And there are things that you hate to wait for. Have you ever gone to Starbucks and ordered a drink? And then you're like, why is this taking so long? Oh, it's because of the 50 other people at Starbucks who are in front of you. Right? But like, we need that right now. And that's just your latte. Have you ever been waiting for a text from someone? Have you ever sent a text and you were like, I need the answer right now? And you're like staring at your phone like, come on. Come on. What are they doing? Because you're staring at your phone. So you assume that they're staring at their phone and you're like, I know they have their phone on them. Like, why aren't they texting me back right now? And you get super impatient and it makes you angry. Or it's worse when it's like, I see that they read it. And that's a character issue. But like, still, like, we get, and like, what are we texting that's so urgent? Like, hey, I need to know your latte order. Right? And like, I need this now. I'm in line. That's one thing. If you start to drive, you're going to be stuck in traffic at one point. You're going to hate it when you hit every single red light on the 76. And you're like, these things never line up well. Or you might not be there yet, but your parents certainly are, especially when you're running late. Which we always seem to be running late. Or if you're on Instagram or Facebook or any of those things and you post a picture, I don't do this because I don't have this, but I used to be on Facebook in MySpace, which is a throwback. But you'd post a picture and you'd wait. And what do you wait for? Likes. Or a comment. Which is the weirdest thing, right? You post for it and you're like, let me check. Nothing yet. Let me check. Like, it's only worthwhile if somebody likes it or if somebody comments on it. But we're impatient, so we're always doing those things. Or you ask a question and you want the answer so bad. And you can't wait for the answer, which is why Google is probably the first thing on your phone. When you click your server, it's Google, and then you ask a question and you get your answer immediately. Have you ever asked a question as a group of friends and been okay with like not knowing the answer right away? And just like sitting in and be like, hey, no, don't look it up. Let's guess. And let's just leave the conversation guessing. We won't know for certain what the actual answer is. Probably not. Why? Because you want to know the answer. And then as soon as you find the answer, you file it away and you put your phone back in your pocket. You're like, okay, I'm good. And you move on. Instantly. Like, we always need to figure things out instantly. And the deceptive idea is that we don't have to wait. And the disordered desire is anger or frustration in waiting. And because of that, then we fight for getting everything that we want in the time and way and shape, form that we want it, which is often instantly. But guys, waiting is part of life. And we see it in scripture all over the place. All over the place. From the beginning of the Bible, in Genesis, God tells this guy Noah to build an ark. It takes him 100 years to build that ark. Have you ever done anything for 100 years? No, you haven't. Because you're only 15 or 14 or 16. And like, it took him 100 years before it rained. Hey, do this. It's going to take you a really long time and you're going to have to do it for 100 years. You down? how many of us, like, year one, were like, I don't know. Or month one. Or week one. We're like, look, I cut down the tree over there. But yeah, I don't, how long is this going to take? Is it worth it? Noah's one guy. Abraham's this guy in the Old Testament that we are kind of birthed out of through. And what I mean by that is, like, man, through Abraham, there's this nation of called the Israelites. And man, Jesus, the Savior of the world, comes to the Israelites and he died and paid for our sin. But Abraham kind of starts this off in Genesis. And in Genesis, Abraham is promised a son, but dude's already like 100 years old. And then he has to wait 25 years. Or he's 75 and he has to wait till he's 100. But he has to wait 25 years before he has his son. He can't even wait 25 minutes. And then one of his descendants, Joseph, is this guy. He gets sold by his 11 brothers. He gets sold as a slave. Can you imagine getting sold as a slave by your family members? And he has to wait like a lifetime to be saved out of that, to be proved right, to be, man, rescued from that, redeemed from that. So he's sitting in a jail cell in Egypt for a period of time waiting, and he's done nothing wrong. And then the Israelites, because they find themselves in Egypt, and they become slaves in Egypt for 400 years. The United States isn't even 400 years old. I don't know how old it is, actually. I think it's like 300 now. I could do the math. 1776 to 2022. Somebody figure it out. I'm not going to do it right now. But don't do it with your phone, because that's cheating. 244. Oh, dang it, man. We were so impatient. 244 years. So another 166 years we'd be waiting, or 56 years we'd be waiting. Then, once they're brought out of Egypt, rescued from that 400 years of slavery, guess what they get to do? For how many years? Do you know? 40. Yeah. 40 years, they're wandering in the wilderness, just waiting to get into the promised land. And then when they get in the promised land, they want this king, and they have this one king, King Saul. And this is what we're going through as a church right now, if you're sitting on main service. And they're going through waiting because King Saul is then replaced by this guy named David, and David has to wait until he becomes the king. And it goes on and on and on. And Israel is in exile. And then there's a period of 400 years where they have to wait for Jesus to come. And Jesus comes and he lives this life and he pays the price for yours and my sin by dying on the cross. And guess what you and I are doing right now? We're waiting. We're waiting for Christ's return. But because that's not something that we think about, because that's so far removed and it has nothing to do with this instant gratification, it doesn't bother us. Because it really isn't about us, it's about Jesus. But when it's about you and me personally, it gets frustrating. It gets irritating to our souls. It frustrates us to the point where we start to take action in our own way. Turn with me, if you have your Bibles, to Genesis chapter 15. In Genesis, we've been walking through right from the beginning that Satan, the devil, plants these deceptive ideas that play into these disordered desires. And the deceptive idea that we are talking about today is that you can be like God. Right? That's what he says to Eve in the garden. Hey, did God say that you can't eat from this tree? Well, no, but if we eat of it, we will truly die. No, you won't die, but God knows that you will be like him, knowing good and evil. the deceptive idea is that you and I can be like God. And Abraham, one of the guys that we were talking about earlier, Abraham receives this promise from God that he is going to have a son, and that this son is going to have descendant after descendant after descendant. And so Abraham, and you need to understand something, like it's a very different culture back then, where to have someone to pass on your legacy to was massively important. If you didn't have an heir, if you didn't have a son to kind of take on your wealth, all of your property, it was just left to no. And that still happens, but it's not as important to us. Like many of us, because we're so selfish, we don't think about like the lineage of our family and the representation of our family anymore. Like most of us aren't thinking like, man, I can't wait to leave a legacy of the character of person that I am for generation after generation after generation. Most of us are thinking like, I just want this right now. So Abraham really, really, like the importance of wanting a descendant is massive, mainly because of the promise that he receives from God, but also because of the cultural significance of having an heir. And so Abraham is promised a son. And in chapter 15, God says to Abraham, verse 5, he says, "Look toward heaven and number the stars, if you are able to number them." Then he said to him, "So shall your offspring be." And he believed the Lord, and he counted it to him as righteousness. God promises Abraham this heir, even though Abraham is old and has no one to, like, no understanding of how this promise is going to be fulfilled. And so he's waiting. And he's waiting for a number of years. And if you jump now to chapter 16, Abraham's wife, who's also old, Sarai, Abraham's wife, had borne him no children. Verse 1. She had a female Egyptian servant whose name was Hagar. And Sarai said to Abraham, "Behold now, the Lord has prevented me from bearing children. Go into my servant. It may be that I shall obtain children by her." And Abraham listened to the voice of Sarai. Does this sound like a good idea? It's not a good idea. So often you and I will hear something that seems like it's a good thing. Hey, God wants me to be happy. And that's what we talked about a couple weeks ago, right? Austin fleshed out, man, do we trust that God wants our deepest happiness? Our deepest happiness. When you take out that deepest and you just put happiness, it becomes circumstantial and it becomes whatever you want when you want it. And so when we say, well, God wants me to be happy, so therefore he wants me to have these things, X, Y, and Z, whatever your thing is. God wants Abraham to have an heir, so naturally Abraham's like, Sarai are like, well, here's a way that we can make that happen. And you and I in the 21st century, we look at this and say, well, that's a terrible idea. Obviously not. This was a very common practice back then of wives and their servants. It doesn't mean it's right, but it means it happened. And so Abraham does sleep with Hagar and does conceive a son named Ishmael. And that becomes a whole problem and a whole thorn in Abraham's side. And it creates tension and it creates stress and it creates a fracture in the family. And it's because Abraham and Sarai said, well, we want this now. This seems like this is what God wants for us. So we're going to make it happen. How many times in my life have I done things that I thought were the right thing because I wanted them right now, and it's blown up in my face? How many times have you thought this is the right thing and you do it right now and it blows up in your face? Anybody make a decision in your life that turned out terribly? A few? Or turned out like awful, probably shouldn't have done that? The one that comes to mind in my mind right now, and this is a little bit far from you guys, but I was actually, before me and Carissa got married back in college, we lived at and went to a Christian school. And when you're in a Christian school, a Christian college, there's this phrase, this deceptive idea that says ring by spring. You guys tracking with me? So ring by spring is this deceptive idea that says, hey, when you're a senior or you're a junior, like you propose and you get married. That's not necessarily true. It's not necessarily wise, but it's just like the phrase of that culture. And so I proposed to this girl. And she said yes. And we went through senior year and ended up breaking it off. And it was this terrible, rough, icky, uncomfortable breaking of a relationship simply because I thought, well, this is what I'm supposed to do. I want this now, so I'm going to do it. And this was a decision that I made that blew up in my face. As a freshman, as a sophomore, I can't tell you how many relationships I got into simply because I thought, well, this is what I want. This is what is good for me. And so I'm going to step into this relationship and break up a week later. You guys ever notice like when you're with your friends and you're like, no, it's pretty serious. We've been dating for like 3 weeks. Because the unserious relationships are like 1 week or like a couple days. But it's like, no, we've been together for like 3 months. So it's like a big deal. Because like 3 months, your freshman year, like that's the first semester. It's a lot of time. But it's still only 3 months. And we make decisions like for instant gratification that turn out to not be the best decision simply because we're impatient. And here's the lie. Here's the lie that Abraham believed. Here's the lie that I believed. Here's the lie that you believed, that you and I can be God. And the decisions that you make are going to turn out perfectly and that you're going to get everything that you want when you want it, which is why you get upset when things don't go your way, or I get upset when things don't go my way, which is why I get upset and I look at my card and I cheat in a silly game that has no bearing on my life. But it's the same reason why I get upset when I'm standing in the grocery line and I'm waiting for the person in front of me who pulls out a big box of coupons. Right? You guys have to do this. I'm not the only one who does this. But when you are in a grocery store, and you're going to check out with your item or two items, what do you do? Self-checkout. What don't you do? Oh, man, there's like six people over there. I'm going to stand in this line. You never do that. You're always, no, not over there. Okay, wait, hold on. Come on. Mom. I found it. Right? You do this. We do this. Or it's self-checkout. And you have like 56 items and you're like, beep, 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 beep. And everyone else is like, oh my gosh, it's a 15 item limit. And you're like, no, but there was no line. Boop, boop. Right? We do this. Instant gratification. We want what we want now and we will do whatever we can to make it happen. And the problem is that we live in a culture that allows us to actually believe that we can make things happen instantly. Listen, you and I live in a culture that is very convincingly curated, designed, giving you and me access to actually believe that we can make things happen instantly. You walk into a room and it's dark, what do? You flip on a light switch and the light turns on. Guys, rewind like 200 years. You know what you had to do? You had to go find a candle and you had to go light a match. And you know what you had to do a couple hundred years before that? You had to make that candle. In that match, just so you could have light. And you know what you did before that? You sat in darkness. You went to bed. That's what you did. I used to be amazed. If you read about like Christian men and women of faith, like from the 1500s or whatever, you're like, man, these guys woke up at like 5 or 4 in the morning, but they also went to bed at like 7 o'clock because that's when it got dark and there was nothing to do after that. But what do? We turn on the lights. We turn on the TV. We look at our phones for hours and hours and hours at a time. What else do we do? You don't like the way that you look in a picture. What do? You edit it. You filter it. So we can actually think and change our appearance in such a way instantly. Oh, I'm going to put this slimming feature on. What do I look like with blue eyes? What do I look like with brown eyes? What if I like just kind of tweak it a little bit? Like, instantly we can do this. And that's not the only place we do that. I was at Target the other day. And like, I don't have anything wrong with like makeup or anything, but this was the first time I saw like makeup for men, like in like the beard grooming section. Cause as you guys can see, like I'm trying something new. It's probably not going to last, but I thought it'd be fun. So I was looking and I was like, what's that? That's makeup. Even men deserve to be beautiful. That was the phrase. And you know what the advertisement was? Is that you're not good enough. You got to change yourself and you can do it instantly with this item. You can do it instantly. You can change yourself instantly with this filter, with this makeup. You want your coffee? How do you want it? What way do you want it? We're going to make it your way. You want a Big Mac with no lettuce? In-N-Out, you want grilled onions, chopped onions, you want chopped peppers on the side, you want cheese, you want whatever you want, baby, I got you. That's what we do. And that's what we're catered to. All the time we're catered to. Anybody ever watch the movie Ready Player One? Trips me out. Ready Player One is, if you're not familiar with the phrase, it's like the metaverse. Right. So you can go virtual. Like my cousin has the Oculus game set. It's weird how easy you can just be in another world. So like, yeah, basically it's a virtual reality where you're in another space and you're playing these games. And the metaverse is just that concept blasted out even farther, where there's other worlds, but it's all virtual. It's all online. And in Ready Player One, which is a movie, it's that concept, and you can change everything about you. You can change your hair. You can change your features. You can be a cat if you want to. You can be a dog if you want to. You can be a big robot man if you want to. You can do whatever you want in the metaverse. And the problem with that thinking is that listen to me. It's not a good thing, because we can actually believe that that's who we are, and we can change ourselves and tweak ourselves to be what we want to be when we want to be it. And we start to think that we're God. And we start to act like we're God. And when things don't go our way, we get frustrated with people and things and places, because we actually believe the deceptive idea that Satan plants is that you can be like God. Which is why instant gratification is the disordered desire that is birthed out of that in any and every area of your life, from your sexuality to your Instagram account to how you relate to your siblings or your family. I want it now. You're getting in my way. And I should be able to say, like God, let there be light and there be light. So I flip on this switch. Or I should be like God. I want to travel over there, so I'm going to get on this plane. And even though it's 5 hours, it's still pretty close, so I'm going to get there as soon and fast as possible. I love the phrase that you guys see on our wall. If you guys are watching online, it's hold fast, live slow. Hold fast to Christ, live slowly. Jesus teaches he is the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through him. He is the way of being a human. Jesus walked and lived in a very unhurried, unrushed way where interruptions didn't bother him because it was him leaning in and trusting in, and this is the truth, trusting in God's character, God's plan, God's timing, and letting God be God and Jesus submitting to God the Father. And in so doing, he displays to us what it looks like for us to trust that God is God, we are not, and live and walk in his timing. Do you know what Jesus did when he was on the way to heal a 12-year-old girl who was dying in a bed? Jesus was on his way to heal this girl, and a woman touched his cloak. And she was healed from a 12-year of an illness. Jesus stopped, paused, found this woman, looked her in the face, and said, "Your faith has made you well." And he spoke to her. This woman would have not been spoken to, not been loved, not been seen. She would have been an outcast for 12 years. And Jesus stops and engages her because he was in tune with his Father. And then he went on and he interacted with this family and healed this young girl who ended up passing away, and he rose her from the dead. Jesus lived in a way where when interruptions came his way, he saw them as moments to reflect and display the grace of God, not fight for his own kingdom, but to fight for his Father's kingdom, which the Trinity, that gets a little bit confusing. I apologize. So for us then, why does waiting rub us the wrong way? We've talked about it. If you get frustrated in waiting, it's because you genuinely believe this is what it is. If you get frustrated in waiting, when you get frustrated in waiting, it's because you think that you are like God and that you don't have to wait. Every time. With a relationship, with a family member, with traffic, with a latte, whatever it is, you feel like you and I believe that we are worth being responded to immediately and things bending to our will in our way. So then, in waiting, it helps us to trust in God's timing and not our own. It helps us to lean in and humble ourselves to the fact that we don't need the pressure of being God, and we can let God be God. Because when things don't go your way and you're frustrated and you're anxious, is that a good place for you mentally, physically? Do you feel great in those moments? I don't, which is why when I'm stuck in traffic, I physically feel anxious. When someone's not responding to your text, do you physically feel a way about it? When your siblings or your parents are withholding something that you want right now, do you have a physical response that says like, "Oh, this frustrates me. I'm upset. I'm angry." In those moments, you and I get to pause for a second and realize, I'm not God. I'm going to let God take care of this. And if I choose to, then I can be released from, you and I can be released from the burden of needing things our way and say, "God, I'm going to let you handle that." That is absolutely a choice that we get to make. It is a choice that you get to make in that moment if you want to make it. So then one of the ways that you and I can practice this, restoring our souls in this, would be getting in the long grocery line purposefully. When you drive, purposefully driving in the slow lane. When you walk up to your campus, I don't know how this works. Do you guys have, on your cafeterias, do you guys have options to choose from in lunch, or is it like, here's your lunch? You get options? Purposefully choosing the slowest option. Purposely choosing to go and stand in the line that your friend wants to stand in line with, not what you want. This is a practice. Purposefully, like putting your phone down and not touching it when it buzzes. Like, see how long you can do it. You're going to feel a certain way about it. Just like you're going to feel a certain way standing in that line at the grocery store. Just like you're going to feel a certain way about standing in line with your friend in the cafeteria. Just like you're going to feel a certain way about asking a question, like about like nature and not looking it up on your phone and just trying to think about it. You're going to feel actual ways about this. Your body is going to feel tense about this because you and I, we are one being, soul and physical body, flesh and blood, but also so much more than that. And so your body is going to respond to this practice of patience, practice of denying yourself. Jesus says, if anyone wants to be my disciple, he must take up his cross or deny himself, take up his cross and follow me. And this is an invitation to practice this. It's not going to be an easy thing for us. It's not going to feel good for you. It's not going to feel good for me. It doesn't feel good for me. I don't like it. You won't like it, but it's good for your soul. Why? Why do you think it's good for my soul? Because it reminds me I'm not God. It reminds you you're not God. Guys, it's a lot of pressure being God. You don't want that. Not for your own life and not for everyone else's either. Some of the benefits are that it writes your soul to him. Psalm 27:14, wait for the Lord, be strong and let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord. Isaiah 40:31, but they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Lamentations 3:25, the Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. Psalm 37:7, be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. Fret not yourself over the one who prospers in his way, over the man who carries out evil devices. Simply trust in the Lord. Psalm 135 through 6, I wait for the Lord. My soul waits, and in his word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than watchmen for the morning, more than watchmen for the morning. In the waiting, your and my soul begins to be restored. Do you want to be freed from the anxiety and pressure of needing to fight for your rights in your timing every single day? If so, the invitation is to wait on the Lord. And that process of waiting can restore your soul and free you from anxiety. So, deceptive idea, you can be God. Disordered desire, instant gratification. Christ frees us from that if we let him be Lord of our lives and not ourselves. Let's pray. Lord, I thank you for this morning. I thank you for your grace. I thank you for the gift of waiting on you. Would we not run and make decisions in our own thinking and in our own might, but simply in your good and right grace? In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.